Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, where we will provide you fresh insights into South Asia's geopolitical, strategic and security situation. Let's take a look at the headlines first. Pakistan struggles with economic challenges amidst rising inflation and political instability. Terrorists target non-local guide in Jammu and Kashmir's Shopia district. And Baloch activists call Khuzdar blast part of genocide. Let's begin the show by delving into Pakistan's ongoing economic challenges. The country has been reeling under massive economic woes. Despite the transition to a new government, recent weeks have seen a surge in the prices of essential commodities such as electricity, gas, petrol, food and clothing, thereby elevating the cost of daily necessities for the populace. The surge in inflation has hit hardest the families of salaried and middle-class individuals, making Eid al-Fitr shopping incredibly challenging and leaving many distressed and disheartened. We have a report.
2023 was a tumultuous year for Pakistan. Mass protests, political instability, terrorism, economic crisis, the country saw it all. This year is no different than the previous year, as the nation finds itself entrenched in an economic quagmire while grappling with a surge in militant activity, deepening concerns about its stability following the February 8 general elections. Pakistan's economic crisis continues to worsen as the country struggles to cope with mounting debt, global inflation and a sustained drop in GDP growth. According to a recent World Bank report, around 10 million individuals are at risk of falling into poverty amid sluggish economic growth and soaring inflation. The international lender is concerned about the South Asian nation's weak economic growth of just 1.8% and the skyrocketing inflation rate of 26% in the current fiscal year. Furthermore, the impact of this economic strain is deeply felt by the populace, with essentials becoming increasingly unaffordable for many. Local voices echo the sentiment of extreme difficulty in purchasing basic items due to exorbitant price hikes, pushing many beyond their buying power.
खरीदारी में तो इस टाइम पे यानी बहुत समझ लें एक्सट्रीम लेवल पे मुश्किलात पेश आ रही हैं, क्योंकि जो चीज़ समझ लें पहले हम 300 रुपए की ले रहे थे, वो इस टाइम पे 800-900 रुपए तक पहुंच गई है। यानी आपकी जो सकत है उससे बहुत बाहर, डबल से भी ट्रिपल रेट हो गए चीज़ों के। अब ये आप थैला देख रहे हैं, ये इतना सा थैला है, ये आप बिलीव करेंगे ये 15,000 से ऊपर का है, ये इतना सा थैला, ये बच्चों के कपड़े हैं खाली। तो ये महंगाई का हाल है इस टाइम पर, और अभी भी ये कम्प्लीट नहीं है, ये हाल हो गया।
पाकिस्तान इन्फ्लेशन डिड कास्ट अ सोम्बर टोन ओवर ईद फेस्टिविटीज टू। ईद फेस्टिविटीज ट्रेडिशनली अ टाइम ऑफ जॉय एंड सेलिब्रेशन वर मार्ड बाय सबडूड स्पिरिट्स दिस ईयर ड्यू टू राइजिंग प्राइसेस। मेनी फैमिलीज फाउंड देमसेल्व्स अनेबल टू अफोर्ड कस्टमरी शॉपिंग एंड फीस्टिंग। The high cost of essential goods and services strained household budgets, leaving many families unable to afford new clothes, gifts, and special Eid treats.
महंगाई के ऊपर क्या कह सकते हैं? अभी तो कुछ खरीदारी करने के लिए आए थे, लेकिन जैसे रेटें सुन रहे हैं, लगता है कि खरीदारी भी नहीं हो पाएगी सही तरीके से। ये लोकल चप्पलें 1500-2000 रुपए की मिल रही हैं, तो 700-800 रुपए की मिला करती थी पहले। खरीदारी तो एक आम बंदे की फरोख से तो बहुत दूर हो गई है। किस तरीके से करेगा एक आम इंसान खरीदारी? ये तो फिर भी एक 60-65 हज़ार रुपये कमाने वाला बंदा बोल रहा है, जो इससे भी कम कमाते होंगे उनके लिए तो खरीदारी करना एक ख्वाब ही हो जाएगा।
लोग परेशान है इस टाइम, हालात बहुत ख़राब है लोगों के, लोगों की महंगाई के हिसाब से जो है हालात बहुत ख़राब है लोगों के, और जो है महंगाई बहुत है मुल्क के अंदर, लोग कोई चीज़ खरीद नहीं पा रहे, हर चीज़ महंगी है, चप्पल से ले गए जूता कपड़ा ये वो हर चीज़ महंगी है। तो रमजानों में लोगों ने बड़ा मुश्किल हो गया लोगों का गुजारा। इस हिसाब से सदर साहब से मेरी अपील है कि पैसे पेट्रोल पे भी कम करें, कि आवाम की थोड़ी परेशानी कम हो और ईद पे लोग शॉपिंग कर सके।
दिस इकोनॉमिक स्ट्रेन नॉट ओनली डैम्पन्स द फेस्टिव एटमॉस्फेयर बट ऑल्सो एग्जैसिबेट्स फाइनेंशियल स्ट्रेस फॉर ऑलरेडी स्ट्रगलिंग इंडिविजुअल्स एंड कम्युनिटीज। Many people are struggling to make ends meet and the poor and vulnerable are being disproportionately affected. Pakistan is experiencing an ongoing economic crisis as part of the 2022 political unrest, economic crisis and catastrophic flooding. It has caused severe economic challenges for months due to which food, gas and oil prices have risen. Moreover, excessive external borrowings by the country over the years raised the specter of default, causing the currency to fall and making imports more expensive. The ongoing challenges in Pakistan paint a grim picture of the country's future unless urgent measures are taken to reverse the downward spiral.
Let's now move to Balochistan, where locals expressed grave concerns about the recent explosion in Khuzdar, claiming it was a part of the ongoing genocide against them. Baloch activists, including Dr. Maharang Baloch, charged the Pakistan government of carrying out a planned genocide and reiterated their resolve to oppose colonial tactics. Pakistan's intelligence agency, Inter-Services Intelligence, has been accused of carrying out a range of atrocities in Balochistan, including kidnapping, murdering and torturing victims in order to instill fear. A report.
On April 7, a deadly blast at a populated area of Balochistan's Khuzdar district killed several people, while many others sustained injuries. According to the police investigation, the explosives were planted on a motorcycle. The powerful unclaimed explosion at a busy shopping area raised serious questions among local Baloch people. Condemning the attack, local people and activists labeled the incident a part of the ongoing genocide against the Baloch people.
I think there is a possibility this attack done by death squad and these religious terrorist groups, which are being supported and facilitated by Pakistan Army, just because to sabotage peaceful protest of Baloch movements. Recently, we have seen Baloch Jaggeti Committee Long March highlighted Baloch missing person issue widely in the world, and international media, including human rights activist, United Nations officials, including Malala, raised the voices for the Baloch Jaggeti Committee peaceful struggle. So I think this is the tactics of the Pakistan Army to stop Baloch Jaggeti Committee's peaceful protest in Balochistan, to stop them to come out on the street and protest against Pakistan Army atrocities against Baloch people.
On the social media platform X, activist Dr. Maharang Baloch condemned the Pakistani government for lawlessness in Balochistan and allowing criminal groups and individuals to roam freely. Accusing the Pakistani state of engaging in a systematic genocide, Maharang reaffirmed that the Baloch people will keep resisting these colonial strategies. Moreover, Maharang and thousands of other Baloch chose to march on the roads against the state-sponsored atrocities during Eid, when the entire country of Pakistan was celebrating the holiday.
सरचमी बलूचिस्तान है तुका बलू अंचे हजारा बलूच मातु गोवा रस्ता क्या वती पी गुआ मर्दुमानी वदारा कनगा क्या कद पाकिस्तान टास्टर सेला तू कशेला बनती वो आनी खानदान सरजम बिकती हमी गारू बी गुआई की एक मे वस्ता एक राजी दर्दी एक जीड़े हमी गारू बी गुआई यरा एक प्रोपेगेंडा द्रोशम रह गया वस्ता रियास्ती नुमाइंदा और रियास्ते मीडिया रा रियास्ता लामेदूद बजट दाता कि हर वड़े सियासतदानी नुमाइंदे साफी पार्टी नीरो सरदारे अगा बलूच मिसिंग पर्सन है क्या मजीड़ा से आयर द्रोग रंग दाती ओ आयर मनफी ओ मन ओ मनगढ़ प्रोपेगेंडा वड़ा दीमा कारिते.
On the occasion of Eid, a protest was organized by Baloch students in Islamabad also. The demonstrators were seen demanding the recovery of individuals who had been forcibly disappeared. Amid deteriorating security situation in Balochistan, the local people are urging the United Nations and human rights organizations to take action and hold the authorities accountable for the crimes committed in Balochistan. Activists want a fact-finding mission headed by the United Nations Working Group to investigate the matter. In the Pakistan's most underdeveloped area of Balochistan, the country's intelligence agency, Inter Services Intelligence, has been accused of committing all kinds of atrocities, including abduction, killing, and torture to instill fear. The independence of the Baloch people has been completely stolen by state oppression and economic exploitation. The resource-rich state has been reduced to abject poverty. Since the beginning of the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, the poor region has become a colony of both Islamabad and Beijing.
Let's now talk about a distressing incident that unfolded on Easter Friday in Rawalpindi, Pakistan. A church, a symbol of faith and community, was engulfed in flames in the early hours of the morning, just 3 hours after the Good Friday services, leading to widespread destruction. This event not only highlights the immediate loss suffered by the Christian community, but also shines a harsh light on the broader issue of discrimination faced by minorities in Pakistan. We have a report.
On the night of Easter Friday, a church in Rawalpindi was set on fire at around 3 a.m. in the morning. The fire destroyed fixtures, fittings, and items stored inside the church for Easter. The parish claimed that the inferno was the result of arson by unidentified miscreants. The Christian community complained to the police about the fire. Despite their belief that miscreants were responsible for torturing the church, they claimed that the police inserted in the FIR that a short circuit caused the fire, a statement not contained in the original application. This incident highlights the discrimination faced by Christians under Pakistan's constitution.
From what we know, local sources have also verified this information that in fact the church was put on fire by some miscreants, and the reason was that because the church wanted to hold some kind of Easter activity outside in the front of the church, and the local businessman or local influential did not like that and said this should not happen, and on the day of the Easter then this attack against the church happened.
This is not an ideal incident where a Christian church has been targeted. In August last year, mob attacked churches and homes of Christians in Faisalabad city in eastern Pakistan. A fact-finding report by Human Rights Focus Pakistan revealed the extent of the violence in Jarawala, Faisalabad. As per the report, a staggering total of 19 churches were gutted down and 89 Christian homes were burned down. Furthermore, there have been at least 344 cases of violence against Christians in Pakistan, according to the Human Rights Commission of Pakistan in 2022. This included 10 killings, 138 cases of forced conversions, and 194 cases of blasphemy accusations. This relentless discrimination has resulted in a dwindling Christian population in Pakistan. According to Pakistan Bureau of Statistics report 2017, Christians now constitute 1.27% of the country's population, down from the earlier 1.59% in 1998.
Christians in Pakistan have been facing a lot of persecution, and that persecution is not just from, you know, these incidents of public attacking Christians, the Pakistani public, but also the state discriminates towards Christians and all religious minorities as per the Pakistani constitution. Non-Muslims are not equal. At the same time, you know, there are state institutions which discriminate by employing Christians, for example, and they advertise in this way that, you know, we need Christians for jobs which are menial jobs, like for toilet cleaning or for sewer cleaning, and this is the kind of job that Christians should do. And then also with the laws like blasphemy law, many Christians face a lot of a danger, because many times we've seen that Christian colonies have been burned down in Pakistan, Christian homes have been attacked, Christians have been killed.
Pakistan makes every effort to present itself as a savior of minorities and misses no opportunity to pat its back before the international community. However, the reality is far contrary to the hefty claims made by Pakistan's government. The country has a history of persecuting its minorities, whether be it Hindus, Christians, Sikhs or Ahmadis. Recent years have seen a distressing increase in targeted oppression and violence against religious minorities within the country. This incident raises urgent questions about the need for reform in Pakistan's legal and social framework to protect the rights and safety of all its citizens, regardless of their religious beliefs.
Pakistan has significantly escalated its hostile intentions towards India, particularly targeting vulnerable people who come to Jammu and Kashmir in search of livelihood opportunities and a brighter future. Behind these violent acts lies Pakistan's calculated agenda to disrupt the peace and impede progress in the region, creating an environment that hampers the aspirations and well-being of innocent individuals striving for a better future. Our report.
In yet another targeted attack on 8th April, a non-local guide was brutally attacked in Jammu and Kashmir's Shopian district. Terrorists with their faces covered stormed into a local restaurant where the guide was dining with foreign tourists. The police, meanwhile, cordoned off the area and a hunt has been launched to catch the terrorists. Driver was seriously injured and was immediately shifted to hospital. He has been identified as Ranjit Singh, a native of Dehradun in Uttarakhand. The recent attack is a part of a series of violent acts against non-local individuals in Jammu and Kashmir, with two similar killings reported in February in Srinagar.
The problem that is going on still, I would say, because it has not been eradicated completely, is first and foremost is that the weapons that are there with the underground overground workers of the Pakistan trained people, they are still there and they have those weapons. And whenever Pakistan gives them a signal that they have to create a disturbance, these people come out and kill. Now, this sort of a killing is difficult to check, but the forces, security forces and the intelligence people, they are trying to their level best to corner all these underground and overground workers. Pakistan, as you know, does not want Jammu and Kashmir to be shown as a place which is peaceful and which is progressive.
The latest attack has reignited concerns about the resurgence of targeted attacks on non-natives in Kashmir Valley after a relatively quiet 2023. Throughout last year, terrorists primarily targeted off-duty police officers, with exceptions such as the fatal shooting of a migrant laborer from UP in South Kashmir's Pulwama on October 30, and the wounding of five non-Kashmiri laborers in separate attacks in Anantnag and Shopian districts in July. Moreover, the attacks on the non-local workers started in the valley after the abrogation of Article 370 in August 2019. As security forces have intensified efforts to combat unlawful activities, particularly those aimed at disrupting peace and unity in the Union Territory. The attacks saw a sharp increase in 2021 and 2022. According to media reports, in 2021, there were 25 targeted killings in the region, while in 2022, a total of 29 targeted killings were reported in Jammu and Kashmir. Such targeted attacks also show the growing frustration among the Pakistan-backed terrorists such as the Jaish-e-Mohammed, Hizbul Mujahideen and Lashkar-e-Taiba.
Nearly 20 million people have visited Kashmir Valley in the recent past. This was after Article 370 abrogation. Article 370 abrogation was a big impediment in the movement and the perception of people. After it was abrogated by the Parliament of India, people all over the country decided to come and see Kashmir as it is. And they have found that Kashmir Valley is very peaceful. Now this Pakistan does not want this message to go. Because India conducted the G20 summit also very well, the tourism summit in Srinagar. That also did not go down very well with Pakistan. And that is why they keep trying all these things. And you will find that the targeted killing is against the non-locals, because if they do the killings of the locals will go against all these people. And that is why they say that you target the non-locals. Because non-locals, as you know, do not have much support over there. They come there for their livelihood. Either they are working as the carpenters, masons or other people.
As Jammu and Kashmir undergoes rapid development with infrastructure projects, increased tourism and expanding business opportunities, these advancements directly challenge Pakistan's agenda. Consequently, Pakistan wants to create an atmosphere of uncertainty by killing non-Muslims, migrant workers and even security forces.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Shivangi Mishra signing off on behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.